Hi, everybody. I'm DJ Sixsmith. You're watching Sit Down, joined today by Megan Ranks. You're not special, sort of a memoir from Simon & Schuster. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing great. It's a weird time out there, but plenty of time to talk, plenty of time to read, catch up on stuff. Mm-hmm. How are you holding up with everything going on?
Oh, I'm holding up just fine. I am an extrovert who happens to work at home. And so now that my boyfriend's home all the time, I'm getting so much more social interaction. So I think he's annoyed by me because my personality is just like overwhelming. But I'm doing fine. We're really lucky. And I also discovered that I love puzzles. So that's the bright side of this.
That's awesome. So you've had a really interesting career and people can obviously read about it in your books. So what was it like putting it together and, you know, kind of reflecting on everything you've done?
It was hard. Everyone says authors have always said like, oh yeah, writing books are terrible. And I was like, well, then why do you do it? And I was like, oh, I get it. It's like a pain that you love and you can't stop. So it was very hard. But I think what was cool about it is that it's such a different format than videos and anything else that I've done before. So it opens up a whole realm of being really honest, but in a way that you can think about it. I mean, I should always think before I speak, but sometimes I'm like a word vomit kind of person. So it was really nice to have it could be concise and cohesive and really get what I wanted to say out there. And I have ADHD, so I have a really hard time doing that in conversation. So having it in a book form was great, but it took me way longer than I thought it was going to take me. And I was like, oh wow, this is awful.
How long did it actually take?
Well, it took me, I wrote the first draft 5 years ago, maybe more, and I finished it, you know, this year, so it's just like, and then it got to the point where like, it was taking so long, and like, I went through different like publishers and different editors, and I might be high maintenance, apparently, and then it finally got to a point where I was like, oh, there's things that I need to rewrite, because the first draft I wrote part of it when I was like 22 and I'm 26 now. And I was like, oh, you thought you knew everything. Like, ugh. And I'm sure in a couple of years, I'll look back on it now and be like, oh my God, at 26, you thought you knew everything. But I think this version has a lot more like room and openness to grow versus the first version where I thought I had it all together. And I clearly did not.
You've lived a little bit more of life at this point and had some more experiences. Mm-hmm. So when you're going through the book, you know, second time around, like 5 years later, what are some things that popped out to you that you thought about a little bit differently or just looked at a little bit differently?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of it was like self-growth. And when you think that you've learned like your lesson from everything, so you've like a life experience has happened and then time has passed and you're like, okay, cool, I learned my lesson. Except you always go back to learn that same lesson or something else from that exact experience. So there was stuff that I was reflecting on that was even from high school and things like that, that even like a couple years, like 5 years down the road, I could look back on it and understand more and understand how much more like, oh, how this impacted me as an adult or like what those feelings actually were as a, like, it's just easier to figure out exactly what I was feeling and then what the lasting impacts of that were. But there were also certain parts that I wrote when I was single. And so then I was like, oh, I need to update this because like, he's going to read this and be like, what? And I was like, oh yeah, for sure. And like, some, even some of the references, like I was like, I need to take out the Snapchat references and throw in some TikTok ones right. To like keep up with the cool kids. So
it's amazing how much everything changes. I mean, like I'm 26 also, so I'm same age as you, like mm-hmm. Going back to high school, like YouTube was a big thing at that point. You obviously tapped into that. So mm-hmm. Why don't you take me back to the beginning? Like you're growing up in a small town, you mm-hmm. figure out how to do these videos. Like how did the whole thing kind of start up for you?
So I had a friend and I grew up in a big, very small town, knew everybody from either preschool, elementary school, or the latest middle school. But like, that was like, I've met everybody I knew growing up between those ages. And so I had a friend from childhood who she had done YouTube videos for a little bit and she did beauty videos. And so I thought that YouTube was a platform for beauty videos and I didn't wear makeup. I was like a granola teenager who was like, I don't know. I wear sweatpants every day and Birkenstocks. Like I wore Birkenstocks before they were cool. Like
pretty comfortable. I mean, I don't blame you.
Wonderful arch support. Like they were fantastic. Still love them. Still have them. But I was like interested in it from her doing it and she ended up quitting. And then I got mono the summer before my senior year of high school. And I went to a very overachieving, high achieving place where everybody went to like, oh, these pre-college programs. Like I'm going to go study journalism at Northwestern, which is like a slight backhanded compliment to my best friend. And I was very upset that she left me all summer. And I was like, this is worse than you going to summer camp and me being at home by myself. So I had nothing to do. So I started a YouTube channel, and it was back in the time where people weren't getting paid. It was right before that started happening. I remember like my first, I got a $50 check, and it was the greatest thing ever. I was like, oh my God, I can buy like 4 shirts from Forever 21. This is amazing. And yeah, it started off, it was such a different place. And I think because I started, weirdly enough, I started at 16. That was old for people starting on YouTube at the time. And that makes sense now, because you see like, oh, these are kids unboxing toys. And you're like, oh yeah, get them started young. So I was old at that point. And I think it brought a different like level to it, because I was starting, I was already swearing. Like I was making dirty jokes. Like I think people saw me a lot more as like a peer, as opposed to someone who was younger and then had to kind of stay in that younger audience, or someone who had grown up on YouTube and had been doing it for a while, or was just more professional because they were in their 20s and understood that they should be professional online. I was like at that sweet spot where I was like, I don't know, like I'm just gonna do it. And I think people ended up really relating to it, and thankfully that worked. But I don't know if that would work now at all.
Who were some people that inspired you when you were first starting to do your stuff?
Well, because I had thought that YouTube was only beauty videos, I was like, I literally was doing makeup videos and I had no idea what I was doing. So, I mean, I loved their, like, there's these sisters, Elle and Blair Fowler. I was obsessed with them. I loved them. But I also loved Smosh. What was his original channel name? It was like JH Productions or something. But he ended up, Lucas Cruikshank, he ended up being Fred on YouTube, which like blew up. But it was before that. And he would just post videos of him dancing to Hannah Montana with like his siblings or his cousins. And I loved it. But those were like my absolute OGs. And they're still funny. Like one of my best friends now, she doesn't make YouTube videos anymore, but we met because she was making beauty videos. And she lives in LA. She's like a normal job. She like lives in LA. I'm like, oh yeah, how crazy is it? We became like best friends from like the internet when we were teenagers, which is crazy.
So when does life start to change for you? Like, when do you realize like this can be your thing and like I can actually make a career of it?
So it happened in, I think, probably the most humbling way. So I went to college and I hated college. Everyone should go to college. Everyone should try to go to college. But if you don't like it, it's fine, because I hated it and I was miserable. And I had this, I've always wanted to act, and that's, you know, I'm currently an unemployed actor, but I'm like, it's still an actor. It counts. Like, stuff. The people from Game of Thrones, all of them are working right now. They're technically unemployed just because you haven't seen me. So I had, that was always my plan. And that's what I majored in school. And I went to school in Southern California, just not LA, Riverside. Have you ever been to Riverside? It's the worst place on earth.
I've heard of it. I haven't been.
It's the worst place on earth. And everyone who's like lives there or is from there is like, no, you're right. It is the worst place on earth. It's so hot and just miserable. And so I had a really bad college experience. And I was at that point, like looking, being like, I have to drop out. I have to do something. Like, I can't do this. This is terrible. And I like ended up like looking at my bank statements. I was already paying for my apartment and I knew that I was making money, but I did like the calculations. And I was like, okay, I can drop out of college, have enough money for an apartment, groceries, and still like sustain myself. So that's the moment that I realized that I could do it. But I think it was a very humbling experience, because it wasn't like, oh my God, I can buy a Tesla. Like, look at me. Like, I'm better than all of you. It was like, oh, I'm really depressed and I hate it here. I was like, oh, cool, I can leave finally. So that was, I think, the big moment for me. It wasn't as sparkly as I wish it was.
I think sometimes you have to hit rock bottom or just deal with something that's a little difficult, and that kind of shapes you. And like, whether it's, you know, getting mono in high school, dropping out of college, like it's part of the journey. So what have been some of the toughest challenges in terms of building out your whole thing?
Definitely the college thing was rough. I think because I have lived so much of my life online, you either choose to be really forward and talk about everything as you're going through it, or you power through and you ignore the stuff that you're going through and you keep making content. So I honestly think probably the hardest thing for me was to keep making content through all of that kind of stuff. And there were definitely, like, I've done all of like the mental health videos and things where I do talk about that stuff, but I think probably the hardest was trying to find this balance, which I'm still trying to find, of my videos. A lot of people use them as an escape, but then what's my escape? Like, if this is what I'm giving to people for their entertainment and all of that, it's so hard and I think that's why a lot of vloggers have made their videos so much more high production, or they're just doing crazy stuff that you have to plan, because when your life needs to be someone else's escape from their life, then you're like, okay, well, what do I have? Like, what's for me? How do I deal with my life? And how do I know what I'm doing because I want to do it, versus what am I doing because it's what people want to see? So it can kind of feel like a dance monkey dance situation, which I've totally got caught up in. But I think that now I've been doing this for over 10 years, I'm finally being like, oh, okay, now I can get, like, I'm getting into the swing of it. But it takes a really long time. And I think that was probably the hardest. And when people read the book, the most overwhelming response I've gotten from people were like, wow, you're so open online and you've got a podcast and you're so open with all that stuff. And I had no idea any of this stuff was happening, like, behind the scenes. And you were still sharing a lot of stuff, but you definitely, like, it's nice to see that not everybody has it all together all the time. And I was like, well, I'm happy that you thought I had it together at some point. Like, that's very flattering.
I would say there's a lot of pressure in just trying to be yourself online, because, you know, we try to as much as we can with this stuff. But like you said, we are going to withhold things. So what has it been like dealing with that pressure, and also just trying to be as open as possible? Because like you said, like, you can't say everything, but you do want to help people and you do want to help yourself with this stuff.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely hard. I, surprisingly, as much as open as I am, I'm not like an open person in general. So everything that I've always shared has been very intentional. And to be perfectly honest, most of the things that I share, it's because I can't not. It's either like, this is impeding, like, people are going to notice, and I don't want people to, like, talk about something in the comments of my videos or on something, or if I'm not addressing something, or if, like, my mood is shifted. So I've only ever really opened up and talked about things when it's been like, okay, I'm, like, at this place where I'm at a wall where I have to talk about it. I can't not. But it's super, super hard to figure out what is the comfortability of, like, how much you should be talking. And I think now that I'm older and I'm, like, in a good relationship and I have, like, really good friends around me and all of that stuff, I now feel more comfortable going to the internet when I have something that I feel that I've gone through, that I'm going through, that I feel like I have something to say about it and something that can be more helpful and constructive. Because I think when we go to the internet as therapy, the internet's not therapy. Like, there are responses. There's people, like, your therapist normally just sits there and, like, lets you work through it. But the internet's not like that. There can be people who can be really helpful, but it also, you're essentially just, like, letting your feelings out there into the hands of people you don't know if you can trust with all of them. So I think as soon as I built up, like, a really good real life circle, then I feel more comfortable and confident expressing stuff online, because I know I'm doing it because I feel like I have something to say that could be helpful, as opposed to me looking to get help from all of these other people, because that's just, it's just dicey. I wouldn't recommend, it's like WebMDing. Like, it's just not, it's just not a good call.
Well said, Megan. Thanks so much for hanging out. Looking forward to having everybody check out the book, and best of luck going forward, all right?
Thank you so much.